Thank you so much, Alan, for taking time to make yourself available to talk about your mixing process of the score to Mank, the Netflix movie that just came out this December, December 2020. And there were a few special things with that score, either because it's the time of COVID-19 or and all the things that are related to this topic and other things that are very specific to this score and to this film. So it would be great if you could elaborate a little bit and talk us through the process, how it was made, how the musicians were playing, and how you put together everything, and you know, like from the beginning.
Yeah, so they reached out to me to do the score through the musician contractor, Peter Rotter. I suggested that I would be a good choice for that because, you know, I have sort of a bit of a skill set in orchestral music, and I'm pretty good with technology. So they thought I would be a good choice. And, you know, I had enough movies to my track record that were things that Trent and Atticus could go, Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross, the composers, could go look at or listen to and decide. So what it started out was a meeting, a Zoom meeting with me and, that's not true. It started out as a conversation. And then at that time I was doing a movie, I think it was Minions at the time. And so they came to me with this idea of, we need to do a score that sounds like a Bernard Herrmann score from the 40s. And then as it turned out, what they really meant was a Bernard Herrmann score from the late 50s and early 60s, because the 40s were all done in it was a little bit too old sounding. So I started thinking about it, and I knew that we would have to record everyone separately. And we had just, actually it was SpongeBob. We had just recorded everyone separately on this movie, SpongeBob. And so I, in the process of doing SpongeBob, learned a lot about home recording in the pandemic. One of the things that I learned, and the reason I'm telling you the story, you'll understand in a minute, is that everyone records things their own way. They have their own mics. Everyone thinks good is something different than what everyone else thinks. So I'd have a couple of violinists, and one would be micing himself from 6 feet away with a condenser mic, and one would be micing himself right on top of it with a dynamic mic. And it just was, recordings were all over the place, and it made it very difficult to handle. But I thought to myself, as this Mank project started coming up, that the trick to this is going to be creating a unified environment where they can all work. Like, I was going to have them all in the room. And I remember when Dietz and I met a while back in France, telling me about this reverb, this plugin, this MIR. I didn't even remember the name of it at the time. And so I reached out to Dietz, and of course he was gracious enough to talk to me, and said, is this something I could do with this? And he's like, absolutely, that's what it's built for. So you guys got me the plugin, which I was very grateful for. And I started experimenting around with it. And Dietz helped me by writing a couple of scripts for me so that I didn't have to start from ground zero. I'm very bad at starting from ground zero. I'm really, really good at starting from three. I'm not so good at starting from zero. But Dietz got me to three. And I experimented with on SpongeBob just as a proof of concept for me, you know, so that I could then go forward and say, I got this idea. And it worked really, really well. And I ended up using it in some aspects of the movie. They loved it. Hans called me up after I mixed it. He goes, so this sounds like it was recorded orchestrally on a scoring stage. And I'm like, yep. And so it was very successful. But the trick with that was I was able to, because it was a Zimmer score and there was a lot of production, I was able to hide behind samples and hide behind production. So I knew I was going to use the samples and augment the samples with live instruments. And I also knew that in Mank, that was not going to be the case. I was not going to be able to use any samples at all. Mm-hmm. It was all going to be live players.
So this is all live?
All live.
Only overdubs?
Only overdubs.
Wow.
Every single instrument on there is live. So every now and then I use a shade of a harmonic. I allowed them to not record the harmonics, you know, the string harmonics when there's a high string harmonic, because Because the truth is, it doesn't sound that much different than the sample, you know. So I scratched my head for a while, I stroked my beard for a while, and then I had this meeting with Trenton Atticus, and I said, well, here's my idea. I have this software that I'm using. It's very, very specific. And what it enables me to do is to place the instruments inside of a common hall, and that I can actually position them in this hall, and it would be a singular space, and there are spaces to choose from, and I can do mixes for you, and you can literally pick the space you like. I mean, and do it that way. And I said, but the trick, part of it is going to be, my experience was that everyone records their own way, and we want to make this sound like it's, you know, from the 40s or 50s. So I own a lot of ribbon mics. I own like 25 ribbon mics. And so I said, let's do this. Let me be in charge of distributing a microphone to each player so that they're not using their microphones, but they're using my microphone, and then I'm going to tell them where to put it.
Right.
And then the only thing we're dealing with that's different is the rooms that they're in, but I'm going to keep the microphone close enough to them that it's not going to make that much of a difference. Mm-hmm. And Trent and Atticus loved this idea. They went right to David Fincher and said, we've got a plan. And they said, we just had this idea. I'm like, okay, well, you know, we being you and Atticus, or we being the collective us, but I'm used to that. So it's, you know. And so we did that. We made a list of players. We got all the players. We made a list of my microphones. I got this phenomenal guy named Gustavo Warner involved, who owns a studio in Burbank called Igloo, who had had a relationship with Netflix for distributing stuff to musicians during COVID, because they had all these specifics about cleanliness and disinfecting and stuff like that. And Gus's company does a lot of voiceovers and stuff. So they were having to get voiceover setups to different people. So they had this relationship. So I called up Gus, who's a friend of mine. I said, let's do this thing. And I gave him my list of mics. He goes, hey, I have this KU3. You want to try that on something? And I'm like, sure, let's, you know, so we built this world, right? And we sent it out to all the players, and we got, I'm going to count as we talk, there's four violins, two violas, two cellos, it's eight, one bass player, nine, two flutes, two oboes, 11, 13, two bassoons, 15, two French horns, 17, two trumpets, 19, two bones, 21, two to 22, piano, harp, and then percussion, vibes, timpani, orchestral percussion, all that stuff. So we're like 25 players, you know, a lot of and they were all doubling, tripling, sextupling. So it was a lot of material, you know. And so I said to them, let's do this. Before we dive in all the way, let's do a proof of concept. If we can have you book the one session and just do a couple of cues, and let me do a proof of concept. And they were like, fine. So we did that. They recorded the opening and then one or two other cues. The big band at this point was separate and remained separate. So we did that. And Dietz, again, helped me get my script together and what I wanted. And I can't tell you how much time I spent stroking my beard over this. Just, you know, I knew I had to do it in stereo. I couldn't rely on surround. I was like, they didn't want big pannings. They wanted everything kind of mono-ish and it was very tight. And I knew that the magic was going to be in front to back and not left to right, you know. And so I had to learn how to use the software, you know. And, you know, there's like inside of the mirror, you can EQ each individual instrument's feed into the environment differently. And so Dietz helped me with that. Just he had some preset EQs that I started with and then changed them from there and everything. And I did it forever. And then, you know, that the worst thing is when you print that first mix and you hit send. And I sent it to them and I said, awaiting to be fired. And I got about half an hour later, I got an email back from Trent. Atticus takes a little longer. And he goes, I don't know what Atticus thinks, but this is phenomenal. And we were off to the races. And then the funny thing was, what was phenomenal on the first day ended up not being anything close to what ended up in the movie. Their opinions changed. They got used to the environment. They got used to what could they ask for? How could they change it? What could we do? And we got more and more into the weeds with it. So that was mix one. We ended up with mix 7. And then we actually ended up with mix 12. But that's another story, because I discovered that there were certain differences in the way I was treating it. What miking complement was I going to use? I started with like a tree and I ended up with Blumline, you know, and then we tried a different, on some cues, we ended up using a different stage. And we really liked that. So I decided to go back and start trying other cues on that stage and see what worked and what didn't work. So the beauty of this was I had partners in the filmmakers in allowing me to take this as far as I wanted to go. You know, the only thing that really limited us was time. And we ran out, you know, so.
Like always.
So there was really no other choice in this particular film for anything else that would do the job. You know, everything else just sounded like reverb, you know, and this really did this magic thing, which is what exactly this film needed. And I'm proud, because when I watch the film and everyone that calls me says the same thing, you really didn't record this on the stage? All my engineer friends, you really didn't record this on the stage? No. No.
Great.
So that's how the whole thing started. And then it was just the process of, you know, fine-tuning the journey and each piece of music. You know, it turned out that there were different motifs that needed different treatments, and there were certain times where percussion couldn't quite exist in the mirror, so we had to treat it a little bit differently, and there were times where everything was different. But, you know, I started getting into doing a little automation with the wet-dry balance on certain instruments, how I could push things back and forth, and I'm sure as I get better at it, I would learn. You know, I didn't have the time to figure out how to automate the entire, like, viola shell up and down, which you couldn't really do because it resets the convolution, as I can tell. Because when I move something completely, it all kind of spins for a second and then pops in. But changing the level of wetness was pretty simple. And then what you were talking about, scaling the room became a huge part of it. Because certain things just got very washy really quick and needed to be tighter, and certain things felt a little dry and needed to be a little washier. So depending on the cue, I would do different things. So there wasn't one environment that stayed for the whole movie. It was literally became a massive part of the process of mixing, was playing with what was happening inside of the stage that we were creating. And then the automation, the traditional mixing automation, EQ, stuff like that, all that stuff. And then it turns out that when I did want to use reverb, I would use reverb on the output of the mirror. Because so what happens when I got to that point, for those that haven't used it, what ends up happening is the aggregate result of the mix between the dry and the mirror becomes the sound. So you're not sending reverb from the dry and then sending reverb from the mirror. I put it on the aux on an insert, so that became the sound, and that's what I would, when I did want reverb or delay or whatever processing I wanted to do, or EQ, I put it on the mirror output many times, you know, sometimes different, not, you know, there are no absolutes, but that became sort of the general philosophy of mixing.
That's what we call a hybrid approach, that you do not the reverb part within mirror, but the positioning part, and you add additional, your lexicon or whatever, your bricasti on top of it.
Yes, but that would be true. And subsequently, since I've done this, I've used the mirror for that purpose, where I'm just using it as a panner, and then putting my traditional reverb. But in this case, it was the reverb that mattered. Yeah. And then whatever additional reverb was the effect I needed. If I needed the piano to be really distant, in a way that it's a film music kind of style, that was something I couldn't change the entire room to accommodate the piano, because it would affect the violas and everything else. So then in that case, I would add reverb onto the piano. So that's what I figured we'd do. Is, you know, if anyone wants to watch it starts at the very beginning of the movie up until the time where they take Herman Mank out of the car and put him into the room. It goes through the entire opening sequence, the opening credits, and all that stuff. Is this piece of music? So what should we do? Do you want to see it?
Yeah. Can you share your screen? And
I certainly can.
So which room actually did you use here?
Well, I'm going to show you. And I think that we need to look at the Pro Tools session too. So this was the Vienna Concert House Großer Saal stage V2.
Which means the Great Hall.
I was aware of that. I wanted to mess with you a little bit. And as you can see, basically I have an orchestral layout where the strings are in the front, viola on the left, violins in the center, cello on the right with the bass. Valerio is the name of the bass player. On the right, also notice the difference in the positioning of the bass. Hold on, Luigi, I'm dizzy. You want to go out? Goodbye. I found that it was incredibly important how I actually had the positioning set to create the illusion of depth.
Mm-hmm.
And then a harp, which has, and we'll talk about this in a minute, you have the harp and then the flutes and the oboes and the clarinets and the bassoons. They're very traditional. So flute, the way an orchestra is, the basic film score orchestra is set up, and most classical orchestras now, with many exceptions, is it's flutes, oboes, and then the rowback, clarinets, and bassoons. So then we have the mallets, the vibes, which is the vibraphone. And then we have the trumpets here, and then the French horns in the middle, bones on the right, and then the tuba, and then way in the back is the timpani. So if I was recording an orchestra at Sony or at, you know, at the Synchron stage, this would be the first setup that I would have, except for maybe the piano wouldn't be here.
Mm-hmm.
And then the violins, probably the more traditional setup would be, if I had the violins, the viola, and then, you know, you can have the violins like that, the viola there, the cello, and the bass. But in this particular case, you know, I never tried this. Does undo work? It does.
Yes, it works.
So in this particular case, because of the nature of the fact, there were many things that were involved here. One is that the filmmakers asked me to not use imaging that much. They wanted the thing to feel like it was at home in mono.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided we were going to do a little bit of stereo, but that mono was going to be the language of the film. So that because of that, and knowing that the violins had a lot of the melodic content, I decided to put them in the center.
Interesting.
Or at least in this particular tune. And so all of this positioning is wide here, but then the overall positioning, sometimes I would take the insert. So if I go back to the Pro Tools session now, quickly, and if you look at like, for example, on the piano, I have the mirror where it is, but the positioning is positioned in 31 and 67 so that the overall panning of the piano is much less mm-hmm. than it would be if, you know, if I had them out at 100% in Pro Tools. Mm-hmm. So now the beauty of this is we not only have the shell, the left and right of the stage, but within there, we also have, again, what I call sausages of each instrument. So the violins right there, this is left and this is right of the panning I did inside of each individual instrument in the mirror. So how is that really beneficial? Well, say, for example, I did have the violins on the left, right? So in their traditional position. Well, I can pan the first violins from left 100 to zero, and the second violins from zero to right 100, and literally create the section inside of the shell of the violins as they would be set up on stage. You know, and maybe in the future, one of the things that would be interesting is if I could change the width of this ellipsis so that I would have even a more of a front to back environment inside of the violin so that I can, you know, set the rows back. So sometimes
I understand what you're asking for, but wouldn't it be easier just to have a second icon and use this for your back seats, so to speak?
Which is exactly what I did with the woodwinds. Okay. And yes, that does work. But then the thing is that there are times where I wouldn't want that. And unfortunately with films, when you're looking at having to do 60 or 70 EQs per film, the thing that you try to do is keep your preset, your template the same, and then make your changes inside of the template. So to have to like add more boxes to create a second pass of the violins and stuff, unless I really had the time, is something I would probably avoid doing. But yeah, I could. That's exactly right. I could do that. But that's just an outside thought. But the beauty of it was to be able to go left to right, and that left to right be, you know, there were cues where I pointed it front to back. So so I would have my left would be the instruments in the front, and my right would be the instruments behind it, say for, you know, a particular woodwind passage or something like that. Mm-hmm. It opens up the possibilities. That's what this is really about, is it's all about the possibilities of what you could do. So, you know, now looking, seeing all this and seeing all that positioning, if you look at the Pro Tools sessions, and now we have, these are up here. So here's my violin section. Here's my four violinists. And what I did was, this is each individual player playing the same one part, and there's four parts. So I have four different players playing each part. Mm-hmm. And then I could, inside of my panning environment in Pro Tools, decide where in that elliptical I could pan it, and I could create actually the seating. Mm-hmm. And I actually spent a lot of time doing that, finding that, you know, like this player sounded better all the way to the right. Her sound made more sense as a pure second violinist. This person sounded better sort of, you know, all these are friends, you know, Bruce Dukoff is the number one violinist in Hollywood. He was my core guy, you know, and then everyone was sort of around him. Mm-hmm. Now, remember, in the case of the violins, I had them in the center. So you can see Bruce's pannings are very narrow because I wanted all of his voices to be sort of tight in the center. And then I had all the other players sort of grow outside of that position. Does that make sense?
Yes, definitely. Absolutely.
And then the same thing happens now. The violas are on the left. I have two players, and I decided to go hard left and hard right with this person, Zach. And then Andrew Duckles was the more of the center guy. And then the celli on the other side. You know, and I just went through and I just listened to all the parts, literally. I mean, this guy, Jake Rofi, and Steve Rodoti, they're actually, if you were to see them in an orchestra, they actually sit next to each other in an orchestra. And it turned out that they sort of had a sound that complemented each other so well, simply because that's what they're used to. So I had a lot of flexibility and freedom. Mm-hmm. And then, so there you are. I mean, right there it was, you know, 4, 8, 12, 16, 28, 32, you know, some 50 tracks already. Then the string harmonics, which we left as samples, not going through. And then each of these, so this guy, the bass, was 42.6%. Mirror. Mm-hmm. And then the violas was 37%, and there's no rhyme or reason. This is just all to my ear. Yeah. There was no anyone that, you know, Dietz knows me, and anyone that's listening to this, I want you guys to understand something. I know nothing. Okay. I have no technical skills whatsoever. I don't do anything that's supposed to be, or that is, you know, that I've read that's the right way to do it or the wrong way to do it. Everything I do is just something I do. And that I know a little tiny bit of physics to understand a little bit about acoustics. Other than that, there's no actual skills I have other than me trying my trial and error in things and 43 years of experience, okay? So having said that, sometimes I'll say things which may not make sense if you look at the science, and that's just the way it goes, okay? More than willing to go on Facebook and say Alan Meyerson doesn't know what he's talking about.
It's about the ear, not about the gear.
And I know that when I do my Mix with the Master seminars, that's what I say that in the first 10 minutes. I want you all to understand that you could just pay 5,000 euro to show up to a guy that knows nothing, okay?
But
have at it. You're welcome to leave. No one leaves, though. So.
Nevertheless, I have one technical question, especially in this context. May I take a look at your MIR session? Because I'm very interested if you had the dry distance scaling on or off. Oh, you had it on?
Yes.
Great. So it's a very classical approach, actually.
Yes.
So the dry signal got less and less the more you moved away from the microphone, from the main
microphone. That's right. And that was the whole magic to it. You know, that was like all of this panning and positioning and depth made sense in the environment. You can even see here, I think I scaled this. No, this one didn't scale on the reverb time. This was the full amount. But I used reverb scaling all the time in this thing. And I used different miking positions after discovering, playing with them and just looking for how the image sat for me and the clarity of all of the instruments inside of the image. I ended up, it was so funny. I had a colleague on this fantastic engineer named Scott Smith, who was helping me on many levels. He was editing, tuning, pitching before I got it. He's also quite a good mixer. And so I was sending him my ideas as I was coming up with them. And he was listening and he was super impressed about how good this sounded to the point where he said he couldn't hear any of the usual artifacts you hear when you use digital reverbs. And I would send him three different passes and not tell him what the differences were. And they would all be mic arrays. And then, I was interested to hear what his opinion was. And then this mic array also, I mean, there's so many details, like there are so many cues where I just wanted a little bit more emphasis on the left. So I would take the mic array and do that, you know, or it all sounds great, but it's just a little bit too in my face. So I pull it back a tiny bit. And I had it a little offset to the left in general.
Okay.
This sort of mental exercise, I'm trying to think of a way to say this that isn't rude and dirty, but this sort of masturbation that I do when I work, sort of mental masturbation that I do is sometimes you can't, one of the great things about working at home is I could work as many hours as I want and I'm only going to charge them for what, I don't have a studio I have to worry about, I'm an assistant getting paid a salary, I'm just at home doing this. I would do this for free if they didn't pay me to do it. So
Don't tell anybody.
I do tell them. Believe me, I do tell them, and they pay me well. So, but I spent countless hours in here playing with ideas and what's going to work. You know, I had times where I tried, pushing the timpanis there, but making them fully wet. And, because as you push things back, you hear the depth, and then it changes the amount of wet to dry balance you want to have on that instrument. It's incredible. There's just so much texture and color involved in this environment that is so unique and extraordinary.
May I ask you, you actually reshaped the microphone, the main microphone. Did you, I see you used the bloom line setup in this case.
Yes.
Did you go that deep that you actually did your own microphone setups too, or did you select
some? No, I didn't. I tried to, but I discovered that really was got me out of my skill comfort zone. And so what I did was the ones you set up. So we tried that. I can tell you, I tried the ORTF quite a bit, and then I mean, I tried pretty much all of them, even the hypercardioids and stuff like that. No, I didn't.
You don't want it, no.
Yeah, so I kept, I didn't try the mono one, but it turned out for me, I tried that.
Mm-hmm. This is my favorite.
Yeah, but for some reason, it didn't quite make the instruments on the side sound right to me.
No, it especially not if you want it to be mono, because this is a very, very wide setup.
Well, maybe that had a lot to do with it, was the fact that I wanted that very tight sort of center, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the interesting, you know, I use Bloomline technique a lot, but the thing you find in orchestral recordings, it's very difficult to use a Bloomline technique on like a woodwind overhead, because unless you're willing to live with the reversal of the back lobes.
Yeah.
So that your violas move over there and your violins move over there. But taking it outside of the orchestra like this into this environment is exactly how it will sound the best, if it is the array that gives you what you want from imaging. And the fact that I could, you know, play with moving it, what am I doing wrong? Yeah, there it is. Play with moving it in to be a tiny bit more immersive on certain cues, and moving it out to get away from it. And then I did find that once I got out there, I usually went away from the bloom line.
Mm-hmm.
It got a little too diffuse. And I went, I think, to the ORTF. But again, having all of these options available, and then of course, the option of trying different rooms, which created a massive amount of...
Which rooms did you actually use? Do you remember?
I used the Vienna... this guy, and then I used the synchron stage. Those were the only two rooms I ended up using.
Cool.
And I used the synchron stage on some of the smaller pieces,
mm-hmm.
where there were less players, where there was piano. The end credits was the synchron stage. So if you listen to the end credits of the movie, that's the
synchron stage. Yes, I just did a few minutes before we started our talk, because I think it sounds incredible.
So I was so happy with that. What I did was, on my own time, I was off the clock already because I was onto another movie. But I reached out to Trenton Atticus and I said, look, I'm going to send you a few cues using a different theater. You want me to open it to show you what the 1M1 looked like on the synchron stage?
Sure.
Yes, please.
Okay. And for 1M1, we ended up deciding to stick with what we had, because you have to literally... reposition everything inside, because since the stages are different shapes, you couldn't use the same positioning. So
this is something we've maybe found a solution for a future version, by the way, so that you can define roles to certain players on the stage,
right?
And the players will keep the role when you switch venues. This is the concept. It's not really baked out.
Scale it to that venue.
No, not just scaled, but you can define your favorite positions, so they just jump to your favorite position in another room, keeping the role.
So here's the synchron stage.
Cool.
And it was basically the same position, but I found that I had to close things in a little bit more.
Yeah.
And I moved the bass up here as opposed to being back here.
Yeah.
And I just had to change things around. And I was using...
Secondary microphone.
Secondary microphones, that's right.
Yeah.
And that worked really well on a lot of cues, but it didn't quite work right for the opening cue.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, I actually didn't really scale it back much. A tiny bit.
Mm-hmm.
But... it got to that point where there was so much phenomenal options and opportunities that experimentation became, you know, something that became a large part of the process for me on this, until I started running out of time. And then I just had to stick with the decisions that I made.
Would you use MIR on upcoming projects?
Absolutely. I'm using it all the time now. So what I'm using it for, in a more traditional thing, is, and we talked about it, I'm just making it as a reverb send, where I wonder if, where I just create, you know, like my, for my strings, my brass, and my woods, if I'm going to give them three separate stems, and I just put those three in there as a wide left and right, mm-hmm. and then I just have it as an aux end mm-hmm. going into there. So I've been using it like that a lot. Mm-hmm. You, as a matter of fact, Dietz, you had given me the option, you had told me which stage to use, mm-hmm. and it was, what was the one you had said to use?
For full width?
Mystic Space. Oh, it was this guy. It was this guy.
Yeah, this is a church in northern parts of Austria.
I can't remember. I actually have a session with this on it. But basically, I would just create however many instances I wanted to in surround mm-hmm. for each stem that I'm creating. If I, like, I have my percastes, you know, on one send, and then I always have a secondary reverb on the next send. And so I was using this as my secondary reverb. And it sounds phenomenal.
Yeah, this is in reality an incredibly sounding hall.
Yeah, I love church. It.
And I'm very, very proud that we managed to capture it like that, because it's always a little bit hard to do long reverb tails like that.
Very difficult.
They somehow move. You know, technically they are a linear system, but they aren't. And I'm very proud of that it really works out.
No doubt. It was great. And also, that was a good one. I know I've scaled. I wish I could think of what the session was, because I would open it and show you, but I can't.
No, it's enough, and it's also already good to hear that you are actually using different rooms, because this is what MIR is all about, that you can change your acoustic environment more or less easily. I know that you have to reposition stuff, but in the end, It's like inviting musicians into another room. That's the idea, at least. And it's great to see that you use it in this very, very way.
Which is great, you know. And even when I'm using it in that form, I can even do an individual track where I'm using it as an insert. You know, mm-hmm. It's very, very. It's really something. It's excellent. And I did. I experimented with all the different rooms and stuff and tried to learn it, you know. But it's a big reverb, you know. It's a big sound with a lot of moving parts, and it takes time. So my next film I'm doing at home. I'm going to use it for sure. Mm-hmm. I'm already sure I'm going to use that on a secondary reverb in 5.1. So I might be calling you on a phone to... I know you sent me some 5.1 settings, but...
Even 7.1.
Yes, but I'm not. This one is a 5.1. It's funny because since I'm working at home and I only have 5.1 at home, we've just been doing it. Everyone seems to be happy in 5.1 at the moment.
Yeah.
They're just happy to be able to make music at the moment, you know?
Yep.
So, it's been a phenomenal plus. And I really don't think I could have done that score without it. I mean, I'm sure I would have figured something out, but, you know, it would have been a lot of convolution reverbs that didn't sound good, and, you know, duplicating the track, and, you know, just, it wasn't nearly as elegant as this. And the other value of it in that particular case was the politics of the presentation to the filmmakers saying, this is, we're doing exactly what you want to do. And then they never questioned it once. I never got a call going, this doesn't sound like they're playing together. The only thing they ever said was, it's too wet, it's too big, it's too stereo. More piano, more fluid winds, less woodwinds. Can you try this? Can you move back?
All you were talking stuff. About music, actually.
Music. So never anyone said, it doesn't sound right. We don't get it, you know. It's really, really intuitive once you get into it. And I found that the mix between dry and wet was very, very important. That at first I thought, well, I'll make everything 100% wet, but that doesn't really work.
It's not even meant to be used like that.
Yeah, so I ended up somewhere between 30% and 50% mm-hmm. most of the time. I found that I got a lot of value out of EQing the individual feeds from the individual instruments. So like when I'm putting Gran Casa on a stage and it blows up the stage, that rolling off the low end of the feed to the mirror really helped a lot, and getting in there and getting very specific about stuff like that. And then learn how to save it, which I didn't really know how to do that well. Very good. I'm still, like I said, I'm doing my best. I'm trying my hardest, but I'm still a work in progress. Get yourself some free time in your own studio and do some due diligence with it, because you're going to get stuff that you're not going to get from other reverbs or convolutions or environments. You know. Don't think of this as you can think of this as just a reverb if you use it as just a reverb, maybe on a send and a return and set it up like that. But don't think of it as just a reverb, and don't think of it as, if I can say this, an altiverb, because it's not. You know, it's much, much more than that. It's really the whole concept of depth and distance is on a whole different level in this plugin than it is on any other plugin.
What is the next project you're working on right now?
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, it's been unbelievably busy, right? I just finished Dune with Hans, and right now I just finished this movie called Raya and the Last Dragon.
Okay.
With James Newton Howard. And after that, I'm going on to a movie with Henry Jackman called Ron's Gone Wrong. Another one. I've done six animated features since the pandemic, because it's the one thing they can finish, you know? And then after that, I'm doing the next Ridley Scott movie.
Cool.
And then after that, I'm doing Space Jam and Sing. And then, believe it or not, I'm booked already to do the next Star Wars Fallen Order video game.
Wow.
So that was, we recorded at Abbey Road for 3 weeks with 6.5 hours of music on the last one. And we're going to go do it again. So
6.5 hours of music.
Yeah. 6.5 hours of music. 30 days of mixing. And just an orchestra. No pre-records, no nothing. Just really? Me and a bunch of microphones.
The raw stuff.
The raw stuff. And I just mixed it and they loved it.
Great.
So, thank God I didn't get fired.